Meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. This morning we will continue our inquiry into baseline health protection measures, and today we'll be focusing on schools. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Gary Greenhorn, co-chair of AIDS Resources Network, which is an association of directors of education in Scotland; Larry Flanagan, general secretary of the Educational Institute of Scotland; Margaret Wilson, chair of the National Parent Forum Scotland; and Jim Thewlis, General Secretary of School Leaders Scotland. Thank you for giving us your time this morning. This evidence session forms part of our short inquiry into baseline health protection measures. These measures are the main tools we are using to respond to COVID-19, which include ventilation, face coverings, social distancing, and vaccinations. This is a final evidence session we have planned on baseline health protection measures. The committee will be leading a debate next Thursday, and we plan to highlight the evidence we have heard in this inquiry to the whole Parliament. The committee will also provide a copy of the written transcript of today's evidence session to the Health, Social Care and Sports Committee to inform its inquiry into the health and well-being of children and young people. We therefore very much value your contribution to the inquiry and for giving us your time this morning. Each member will have approximately 12 minutes each to speak to the panel and ask their questions. We are tight for time this morning and have a number of witnesses, so please ask that you keep your responses as brief as possible and don't feel that you have to answer every single question. I apologise in advance, however, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interest of brevity. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking, first question. Firstly, I'd like to thank the members of the Scottish Youth Parliament who provided very insightful evidence on their general thoughts of COVID restrictions and the challenges through the pandemic. And from the young people that gave evidence, there was mixed feelings about the current restrictions, and I was surprised that generally young people are happy to wear face coverings because they feel safer. I think it does show, though, there is still a hesitancy, and although we all want life to be back to normal, there's an element of our young continuing to be quite cautious with COVID. And that leads me to my first question. What feedback have you received about the requirement to wear face coverings in school? And is there a demonstrable evidence that this is having an impact on pupils and pupils' behaviour? Can I please start with Gary Greenhorn?
Thanks, Convener. I think in the papers earlier on, it highlighted that whilst pupils are accepting of wearing face masks in schools, the pupils certainly would like the mitigation to be reduced insofar as wearing face masks in class. There are some probably challenges around communication in classes around the wearing the face mask, and also as we get to the good Scottish weather, there are also challenges being raised by those pupils and staff that wear glasses as well in terms of the steaming up and that presents a hazard. So overall, the behaviour has been okay, and pupils are accepting of it once we got over the initial challenge at the very start of it. But I think it's been embedded well into school management procedures. School staff, teachers and other ancillary school staff are all challenged with trying to make sure we adapt the requirements of the mitigations insofar as the day-to-day operations of schools are concerned. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Greenhorn. I totally agree. I think we didn't realise how much that we relied on lip reading when we were listening to people before we all had to start to wear masks. Can I move on to Larry Flanagan, please?
Good morning, colleagues. Thank you, Convener. I think we should be mindful of the current circumstance. So we are facing in schools at the moment record high levels of pupil infection and record levels of teacher absence. So the issue around all of the mitigations, but specifically on face coverings, is whether they are contributing to trying to keep schools open and safe. And I think in that regard, we are in favour of the continued use of face coverings in secondary schools in class. There isn't really much debate around the use of face coverings moving around schools. Strong consensus here that that's appropriate. We are currently surveying our members and we'll be issuing the findings next week. But you know, as a kind of preview, the majority of our members, whilst you know, accepting that face coverings are an inconvenience in terms of teaching and learning, and teachers as much as pupils would love to be finished with them, but the majority of our members feel that face coverings should be in place across the winter period, given the higher risks that are associated with that. Or at the very least should be in place until we have 90% plus coverage in terms of pupil vaccinations, because that clearly is a critical issue. We've already seen in the data that vaccination of 12 to 17-year-olds is impacting on pupil infection levels, so they're lower in secondary school than they are in primary. And the key factor there is the vaccination rollout. We would have wished for that vaccination program for students to have started much earlier, and we might have been in a better place, but we are where we are. So I think at the moment, we are supportive of the more cautious approach the government is taking, because the critical issue is to try and keep schools open and young people in class and being taught by their teachers.
Thank you, Mr. Flanagan. Can I please move on to Margaret Wilsons from the Parents Forum?
Good morning. There's no clear consensus over the face masks from parents, I would say. Ultimately, parents want our schools to be open and they want them to be safe, but our children and young people are under much stricter mitigations than any other members of society. The feedback that we get is from a broad range of parents. There are parents who are scared, who want their children and the mitigations to continue, and there's also other parents who don't want any mitigations in school. I would say, though, that parents are concerned that it does affect learning and teaching while sitting in class in the senior school, and have asked me to ask at the COVID Education Recovery Group if it would be considered if they could be removed while sat in class. But again, it's just a wide range of views that I can only put forward.
Thank you very much. And I'll move on to Jim Thulis, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, colleagues. Not to rehearse anything that colleagues have previously said in relation to this, but one or two things to make from, points to make from a school leadership point of view. We are broadly comfortable with where we are in relation to the wearing of face masks within school, if not altogether happy. It's not the most optimal of learning conditions, but we understand entirely and we are prepared to live with this going forward, and particularly into the winter. And it has to be noted that any mitigations within, any and all of the mitigations within schools are set within the context of the four COVID harms. And at the moment, the priority for us is to have young people in school and learning in a school environment. And the wearing of face masks is one of the mitigations which we see as important to sustaining that. The point that Mr. Flanagan has made in relation to the level of infection in secondary school and in primary school is an important one to note, and I think we might well pick up on that later. But certainly in relation to a behaviour, it'd be very difficult to unravel a misbehaviour and base it on one aspect, such as wearing face masks. There are other issues related to young people's behaviour within school, not the least of which is the lack of induction experience, which S1 and S2 young people have missed out on in moving into the secondary school. So, you know, behaviour is not a major issue as such, but if we were to investigate into behaviour, I think it would have to be done in the context of much more than just looking at face masks. Not a major problem, but something that would be perhaps worthy of exploring. Thank you.
Thank you very much for all your comments on that. If I can ask Gary Greenhorn this question, what are your concerns around maintaining appropriate ventilation and temperatures in the schools over the winter months?
Thank you, convener. The challenges around that are really what we're experiencing just now, albeit that the winter may result in, depending on the severity of it, there's challenges. Many councils have already taken steps through the increasing the school heating controls to make sure that the heating and the temperature has been increased to compensate for windows and doors being open. The challenge will always be, if we have a severe winter, just how much the heating systems can cope with raising the heating temperature to cope with the external temperatures. And that remains to be seen. But so far, schools have coped really, really well with it. But it does certainly push energy consumption up. And ultimately, the challenges would be around the additional cost of that for many schools. But so far, it's working well. Not to be complacent about it, there still remain challenges. However, if we do face a severe winter, then they could become a challenge on some of the heating systems in schools, the capacity of them not being sufficient to maintain minimum the temperatures. So that's a challenge in terms of probably the age and stage of heating systems in schools, and we are probably looking at that through a number of networks just now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I was going to invite any other witnesses who'd like to comment on that. Don't know if they're able to raise their hand or... Mr. Flanagan.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I couldn't find my artificial hand, so I just used my physical hand here. Sorry about that. I think ventilation is absolutely critical going into the winter, and we have made some good progress in the recent period around a stronger consensus on the importance of ventilation. I would just make the point that we were discussing this last December, because at that stage, aerosol transmission had clearly been identified as the main vector for the spread of infection. So this has not been an easy journey in terms of getting some primacy around the issue of ventilation. And there was some resistance, for example, around even the use of CO2 monitors to do the necessary checks. Again, you know, without totally spoiling our press release next week on our survey, in the majority of schools, our members feel that ventilation issues have been addressed. And it's back to the point that Gary made about the appropriate balance between heating and ventilation, because there is a requirement for school buildings, in a sense, to be overheated to allow for the impact of increased ventilation. And that does mean really basic things like, you know, reorganising the setting periods for when the heating comes on, where there's a boost required because air has been purged in classrooms after breaks. All of those mechanics we think are really important. Our bigger concern is not so much where local authorities have taken effective action. It's where we have pockets and where members are saying they don't feel that ventilation issues have been adequately challenged. So around a third of our members have said they don't feel that ventilation in their school has been properly addressed. Now, we're happy to raise that with individual local authorities. And I know that ADES and COSLA are keen to ensure that we do have a common approach to maximum best practice in terms of ventilation. But there will be individual challenges. And I think one of the things that has to be really clear from Scottish Government is that where additional finance is required in order to facilitate the improvements that are needed, there has to be a guarantee around that. We can't have local authorities or schools holding back on making progress in ventilation because they're not sure if it'll be funded. I think there has to be a really strong green light there that whatever is required to ensure that our schools are well ventilated and therefore safer places, that has to be a cast iron guarantee that's on the table in this period, pre-winter, before we face the real challenges.
Thank you very much for that. I am conscious of time, and my time limit is up. And I know that, Jim Thurless, you did want to come in on this, but perhaps as we go around members, you'll be able to come in on ventilation further down. Can I bring in Meadow Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I wonder if I could raise a slightly different issue, and that's the question of events in schools, which are particularly relevant, I think, at this time of year. And I'm sure you've probably seen some of the commentary that's been in the media around nativity plays taking place in schools with parents present. Now, I'm sure you know all parents and young people are aware what an important rite of passage it is to have your children in a nativity play and be able to watch them. And yet, you know, the current guidance is saying they can't take place in schools with parents present. But as a parent, I can take my children to a crowded theatre or a crowded cinema with lots of other people, some of whom may or may not be vaccinated. And yet I can't go as a parent into a school setting to watch children take part in a nativity play. So I wonder if you have any thoughts on that, and in particular, whether you think it's appropriate that this is a matter dealt with a single piece of national guidance, or given that there are quite varied experiences in different schools in terms of COVID rates, whether there's something there should be some more local discretion on with decisions being taken either at a school level or with local authorities based on the situation on the ground, rather than having a blanket approach. Can maybe start with Margaret Wilson on that one.
Thank you for your question. I think this comes down to transparency, if I'm being honest, that ultimately what parents want when it comes to this, these decisions being made, is where that the what evidence is looked at when they're making these decisions. So I would say that yes, we, like myself, I have received a number of communications about this issue, but ultimately parents need it to be clearly communicated why these decisions are being made and what the thought process was. It is frustrating from parents because you have the national guidance, you then have 32 local authorities, you then have how head teachers are interpreting that guidance. So we are getting communications from very frustrated parents because some are doing events and some aren't. And yes, where is the fairness in that? So on your point of could it go down to local, that's a very good question that maybe we should put to the education recovery group.
Okay, thank you. Well, I'll maybe just go around the panel, maybe ask Gary Greenhorn next.
Okay, thank you. It's a very good question, and it's a question that many authorities have been challenged over, as Margaret correctly says, from parents. So we do take the point. However, I think going back, the primary concern has got to be to keep schools safe. A number of schools are experiencing high levels of staff absence, I think, as my colleague Larry had outlined earlier on. And there are fine balance to be had between increased exposure to risk, and that risk could come from increased footfall to schools, which we're trying within the current guidance to minimise where we possibly can. I think the guidance nationally, as Margaret said, it's all about communication in terms of how we communicate that to parents, but the national guidance is quite clear on it. It's a difficult question to say, do you effectively allow autonomy to local authorities or autonomy of decision making to schools? Certainly, if it's autonomy to local authorities, then an authority can make an authority-wide decision. Autonomous decisions going to schools can be problematic because in a local setting, you have one school doing it one way and another school doing it differently. Certainly, the national guidance is there. All local authorities are adhering to it. However, there is interpretation in certain aspects of the guidance which would mean that some local authorities may interpret it differently. It is a challenge. A lot of authorities are really vexing with just now. However, I think the main concern is, as was raised earlier on, we've got to do everything we can to make sure we've got enough staff in school to keep the schools open as far as we possibly can. And I know there's been a number of challenges highlighted for some authorities where they've had to close schools because of shortage of staff. And I think that point should be made here.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask Jim Thulis the same question?
thank you. Two points to make within this one, and the first one is to do with the national guidance, and what we've done over the course of the past year and more in putting together the national guidance is to try and align what's happening in schools with what's happening in society, and that is, you know, it's caused some rather fraught discussions at times, but the line has very much been to make sure that schools and society are aligned, and you make that point in what you're saying. However, where we have got to discussions on the national guidance is very much in relation to schools being slightly different from cinemas, football grounds and whatever else. Because if schools, you know, if we close down a cinema, we close down a cinema. If we close down schools, then what you're doing is disrupting young people's education. And we've seen within the four COVID harms the difficulties that causes. And I would not wish to be in a position where we were closing a school on account of a spread of the virus, which has arisen through something which did not need to happen. Schools have been very adept over the course of the last year in devising ways of communicating with parents and putting on events in a virtual forum. And I know, for example, that there are many schools with, you know, put on Christmas concerts in the virtual domain. It's not ideal. What we are doing just now is perhaps not ideal in terms of the way in which we are conducting this meeting. But it is a way of making sure that parents are engaged, their young people are actually involved in putting on a performance, and we get some sort of move back towards a normality within the school calendar in relation to what happens at individual points within the year. Thank you.
Thank you. And Larry Flanagan, please.
Yeah. I think, first of all, we should recognise that not all schools run nativity plays, so schools will celebrate the festive period with their students in a range of ways. In most secondary schools, for example, it would be a Christmas concert or a winter concert. And the application of the guidance here is just that, it's application of the general guidance rather than specifically aimed at Christmas. There's been clarification around Christmas because questions were asked, but the general guidance is about minimising the amount of adult mixing there is in the school environment. So it's why we don't have face-to-face parents' evenings at the moment. And the reason that that guidance is there is to try and keep schools open. Because if we have outbreaks amongst staff, schools will have to close because of the staffing shortage. And if we have outbreaks amongst pupils, and we're told constantly by the scientists at CERG that it's not in-house transmission that's the key issue, it's students, pupils mixing with adults, adults mixing with adults. So why would you potentially run an event that is going to increase the infection level in your school community, particularly in the run-up period to Christmas, because it could then impact upon, you know, family celebrations over the Christmas period, when there are alternatives in place. Now, I would agree with your sentiment, Murdo, that as a parent, you would love to be on site watching your children taking part in the Christmas celebration. But we're in the middle of a pandemic, and in primary schools, 5 to 11-year-olds is the highest rate it's ever been in terms of infection levels. So I live next door to a nursery, and I still see parents lining up outside the gate each morning, and the child being collected by nursery staff and taken into the building so that the nursery can be as infection-free as possible. And they're minimising the adult mixing within the building. And that's so the nursery can stay open and provide the teaching and learning for the young person. So I think we have to prioritise. And our priority at the moment would be to try and keep schools open and safe for as long as possible, and not to take what would be a risk, maybe a calculated risk, but it would be a risk in terms of potentially raising infection levels. So again, I think we are comfortable with the guidance as it stands at the moment, because we are still in the middle of the pandemic.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move on to John Mason, please?
Hey, thanks very much, convener. I mean, maybe I could just, seeing Mr. Flanagan's there, carry on with him. I mean, earlier on in the, especially in the pandemic, there was the accusation came to me through emails and so on from some parents that we were overemphasising the well-being of the staff and underemphasising the well-being of the children. How would you respond to that?
I'm not sure that you can separate the two as cleanly as that, because if you don't have staff in schools, you don't have an education process taking place. Now, if you're referring back to the period when we were discussing remote learning versus in-person learning, we have always, from an EIS perspective, we've always recognised the importance of trying to keep pupils in school, because that is clearly more beneficial in terms of the relationship between the teacher and the pupils than the challenge of online learning. Online learning, we made it work, and certainly in the second lockdown we made it work much more effectively than the first. But it is a second best, because certainly with younger children, the relationship aspect is key to the learning process. So the idea that it's teachers versus pupils, to me, doesn't ring true, because I think it's about schools being safe environments, whole school community, and you have to address both of those concerns equally. Otherwise, you do have an imbalance that leads to poor decision making. So I wouldn't accept the characterisation, John. I think the well-being of your staff is important, it's critical to operational issues, but I don't counterpose that to the well-being of young pupils.
Okay, that's helpful. Thanks very much. Maybe I can ask the same question to Margaret Wilson from a kind of parents and young people's angle. Is that your reading of the situation as well?
I don't know what period that you're referring to, but certainly I've been the National Parent Forum. Have been at over the meetings every week, but I think there's been over 70 of them. I've always had a chance to contribute to these meetings. Again, though, it's always a broad range of views, and we do have a young person on the group as well. And usually the young person and I share the same views. I wouldn't say that, Larry's completely right, that you can't separate the two. You do need the staff in the school to have it open. And ultimately, parents don't want to ever go back to remote learning. We want our schools to be open and safe places for our children and young people. But I would say there is a process in place for parents to get in touch with myself, and I can always give their feedback every week. So, and ultimately, though, it doesn't come down to that group. It ultimately is the clinicians that advise the ministers, and the ministers make the decisions. But at least my job as the parent rep is obviously to get as much of those views heard in front of the group.
Okay, I think that's helpful to hear that there's a variety of views on these kind of things. If I could move on more to vaccination, perhaps, and ask Mr. Greenhorn in the first instance. What is the feeling about how are teachers and how are pupils on the uptake of vaccine, just in a kind of general sense?
Okay, thank you. In general, from an IDES point of view, we always wish that the uptake is higher than it currently is. That's the first thing. Communication has been key to that. I think there's an acceptance of the vaccines in general terms. However, there has been widespread reported some comments about it, negative comments in the press from various sectors. Overall, our aim is to support the public health ambitions and the government ambitions, try to promote through good communication to all the staff and pupils where possible to try to get the vaccination rates up as high as they possibly can be. And that then can protect all the schools in terms of being a safe place to be in terms of pupils and staff.
We assume that the uptake amongst teachers is just the same as the general public, the wider population.
I can't comment on that just now, John. I'm not seeing the current figures to compare teachers with the general population, to be perfectly honest.
Yeah, I have a feeling actually these figures may not be available. I just wondered if you had a kind of feeling for it. I'm open to, what about pupils then? I mean, I don't yourself or any of the panel members. How is the uptake amongst pupils going? Is there a resistance there? I mean, it seems to be encouraging, but I don't know if it's tailing off a bit or what.
I think, John, the last stats that they were out, there was certainly there's a variation across 32 authorities in terms of uptake from pupils, and that could be for a variety of reasons. Certainly, the island authorities seem to be at one end of the spectrum. Some of the central belt authorities seem to be at the other end of the spectrum. But again, the emphasis from RDS is to try to support through good communication, peer communication, to make sure if we can try to influence the staff and the pupils to get the vaccination uptake up to levels higher than it is just now.
I mean, maybe I could ask Mr. Thulis then, I mean, do schools have a role in encouraging both teachers and pupils to get vaccinated?
Good morning, John. Just to put a general context to this, we are fully behind the notion that vaccination and the power of vaccination to fight the virus and keep schools open is important. Perhaps to answer in a specific sense one or two of your earlier questions, at the moment, the most recent statistics which I saw were at the tail end of last week was that between 14 and 18-year-olds, a vaccination level is running over 80%, and for 11 to 14-year-olds, it's verging or veering up towards 60%, I think, is the current figure. There has been a wee issue recently, as Gary has picked up there, about the kind of variation across the country. And perhaps a more worrying wee bit is in relation to the fact that it's plateauing a wee bit. And what we are now doing is trying to make sure that we get the message out there, you know, that vaccination is important and the impact which it's having is a positive impact. And I think when you now kind of start to compare primary sector and secondary sector, that the virus is now at its highest level within primary sector, and that has kind of moved on from secondary sector, and we think that is very much to do with the vaccination programme. So we are very, very keen on young people being vaccinated and keeping the school environment safe, and are more than happy to engage with government. We've raised this with government already through CERG, but the notion of using schools and enabling vaccination teams to come in and pick up the kind of the slack which is there just now and get young people vaccinated within the school environment. And discussions in that, I believe, are ongoing just now in relation to the optimal way of using vaccination teams and the school environment to take that forward. So I think to answer your question very generally, fully behind it and supportive of it as a way of keeping schools safe.
Thanks, that's helpful. And we've heard amongst adults that, you know, in poorer areas and amongst some ethnic minorities, there's been a lower uptake. Would that be your understanding among school pupils as well?
I'm not altogether certain about that, John. I don't have the detail of the statistics to be able to back that up.
That's useful to know that actually we don't have these figures. I don't know if any of the other panels would want to come in on this point about vaccination amongst young people. And maybe I could widen it out, actually, and say, well, should we be vaccinating under-12s as well? Margaret Wilson?
Hi. Yeah. Just on your last question as well, I would say that the what I'm hearing anyway, certainly from parents, is the consensus about the vaccinations are that it should come down to personal choice. I would say that they probably don't want... Unfortunately, the teams going into schools, parents want to be able to have a conversation with their children or their young person, and it, you know, obviously, you know, we all see what's going on the TV, and we can have conversations with our young people, but that I would say that what I'm certainly hearing from parents is that it comes down to personal choice, and we feel it's not up to the schools, it's up to the parents and the children. And again, we haven't really discussed the vaccination of 12 to 15-year-olds, but again, I think it would be down to personal choice, and obviously we would have to hear what the clinicians and the advice is, and I suppose as the National Parent Forum's role would be to have that clearly communicated. I mean, we were lucky enough when they did announce that the vaccination of 12 to 15-year-olds, we already had a question and answer session for parents on Zoom arranged with Jason Leach and Marion Bain, and we were able to have parents come in and ask these questions straight straight to the people who are making the decisions. Well, not making the decisions, but advising on the decisions being made in Public Health Scotland along. And those sessions have been extremely useful for parents. And you can see a drop in the communications that come in from parents to me once we've held these sessions, because we've actually had probably about 9 or 10 sessions for parents since February, with people like Public Health Scotland and Jason and Marion, who are given the evidence, and it's clear and concise, and not politicised at all. It's just they ask the question and they get the answer. They've been very useful and very well received by parents.
Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Can I move on to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. I think my questions are really around, almost looking ahead, given that this is the COVID Recovery Committee. I think that despite some of the best efforts of teachers and pupils and parents, obviously education has been affected by a varying degree. And in fact, I was speaking to an English teacher who was saying that, just the wearing of face masks is making teaching difficult, and the pupils, as was said earlier on, we all lip read at some level, and therefore that communication and learning ability was impaired. So I think my question is really, I want to start with, how do we, as we go forward and start to live with this COVID, how will pupils catch up? Will they catch up? And what is the ask from the Scottish Government here? Could I start with Jim Thewlis, please?
Yeah, thanks. Your point is well made, and I think it's important we start to begin to understand the damage to learning which has been caused. And I would suggest there's an obligation upon government now to start looking in detail at the way in which young people's learning has been interrupted, and if it has been damaged. So that's part of the longer term move out of COVID. And once we get past the stage of making sure that we are keeping schools open, we are providing learning to the best of our ability. There is a cohort of young people, and I've touched on this already in relation to S1 and S2 coming into school, whose school experience has been disrupted, and we need to start to look at ways in which we start to supplement and augment anything which we discover in relation to things which have been missed from their educational journey.
I should probably have noted there my eldest is a secondary school teacher, and my youngest actually has through this whole COVID has gone from primary 7 and is now in second year, so she's where you suggest, Mr. Thewlis. Is there anybody else in the panel who would like to come in on this particular issue? Mr. Flanagan.
Yeah, thanks. I'm just slightly nervous at your use, Brian, of the word catch up, as if there was a kind of quick fix to it. Because I don't think there is. I do think we need to understand some of the damage that's been created to the learning process and the learning journey of young people, and the approach to that will vary depending on what age group you're talking about and what time they have left in education. But one of the key issues, from the EIS perspective, is not so much around learning content and knowledge per se, but it's around the social side of being in school, the building of relationships, the building of empathy with others, that well-being aspect of young people. And that's quite labour-intensive. So where remote learning created some isolation for young people, and schools have got a big task about trying to reconnect young people with their peers and reconnect them with their teachers. And I have to say, Scottish Government Education Recovery Plan, there's nothing in it I would disagree with in terms of ambition, but I was left underwhelmed by it in terms of the resource and recognition of the scale of what's required. Because what we need is more teacher-pupil interaction time across all fronts, but particularly for, you know, you mentioned earlier, one of your children transitioning from primary to secondary, so that clearly has been impacted by, you know, the arrangements around COVID. And some local authorities are looking at actually having smaller class sizes in first year so that they get a stronger personalised approach from the teacher. And that's what I think is missing from some of the education recovery, that there's not sufficient focus on groups of pupils who actually need who need extra to overcome some of the disadvantage that the pandemic experience has produced. And I know that the government will say, well, they're looking to employ more teachers. You know, there are big ambitions around that. There aren't enough teachers in Scotland available to meet the scale of the challenges there in schools at the moment. So I think the Parliament needs to up its ambition around what we need to do to support our children so that the impact of the pandemic, not a lifelong experience, is something that, of course, their learning journey, we can address. And the key focus here is about ensuring the well-being and the resilience of young people. And then once we can establish that, then the knowledge and understanding around skills, around their assessments, that will flow from that. But the bedrock is actually making sure that young people are well-adjusted and reintegrated back into school learning communities.
And before I move on to the rest of the panel, if I widen that out slightly, just on a point that Mr. Flanagan makes around teacher numbers, obviously the impact of COVID has exacerbated staff shortages with a higher number of teachers absent from school due to COVID. So that must also impair our ability to give a more rounded education over the piece. So can I maybe ask those questions to be answered by, if we go to Margaret Wilson, how she feels from a parents forum perspective.
Sorry, I didn't understand what you're asking, sorry.
It's just sometimes I don't understand what I'm asking either.
Sorry.
It's more around, it's just really around, my concern is around, you know, the fact that our children's learning has been impaired and we need a plan in place to try and, you know, backfill that. And over and above what I said earlier on, we have the issue of more teachers' absence as well.
Yeah, there's no doubt that there's been a huge disruption to learning and teaching. And I think, I mean, every year, I know that obviously Larry spoke there of a certain year group, but, you know, 5th and 6th years have never sat exams. Your current S4s were left at home longer because, you know, the senior phase last year was prioritised. You've got young people who've had to make subject choices without necessarily meeting parents, meeting the teachers. And then, as you've said as well, you know, you've had children moving from primary up to secondary. And then obviously you've got the transition nurseries to primaries. It's just unbelievable when you're thinking about the, you know, every pupil's been impacted by it all. And I think I agree with Larry that there needs to be really strong resolutions to it, but I don't know how they would encourage more teachers. I don't know as a parent how that would I don't think I can answer that question. But maybe also more support staff. I certainly have seen a difference in where my children are. They've had more people coming in as more support rather than teachers. But I think I can only speak, obviously, from that as a parent. Sorry.
Thank you. My final last point, if I throw this in, just to try and confuse it even further, if I could. there's obviously highlighted a rise in you know, poor mental health among pupils and teachers alike. And I had a figure of something like 1 in 10 pupils have now been referred for poor mental health. So in terms of looking at our overall recovery, from COVID, it is a very, very difficult situation. So again, if I go to Gary Greenhorn really and just get his thoughts around what direction from government we're looking for and what has to happen to help this situation.
Okay, thank you. I think as Ollie Jim said earlier on, there is no quick fix to this. There is a recognition that as a sector, education sector overall in Scotland, we welcome the additional monies that have been put in for COVID recovery. We welcome the rollout of the 100-day commitment from the government, which has already put 1,000 extra teachers into the system. However, challenges that we have in supporting young people on their recovery in terms of the gap in terms of education are the mental health and wellbeing recovery. There is a challenge because absences are still high in schools, and not just with teachers, but with all the support staff. So although we are providing additionality into the system at this current point in time, that's probably been negated by high absence levels. So the challenge is there. I think Larry touched on it as well. Extra resource will certainly be needed once we do that gap assessment that was referred to earlier on, to work out how much of a gap in the learning the young people have suffered over the course of the pandemic. In terms of the mental health and wellbeing, the feedback there just now is certainly there has been an increase. There's no doubt about it in terms of the number of young people that have been referred to that. We broadly welcome the additional money that's been put in for school counselling, which has certainly helped. However, I think that is probably the tip of the iceberg just now. I think that as we go forward in this, young people's mental health and wellbeing will certainly, once it's assessed fully, there will be a demand to address and support that further with hopefully extra resources.
Thank you. I know that Jim Thewlis wanted to come in, if you could.
Yeah, thanks, and thanks for letting me come back into this. And it's to actually link this back to a question which John Mason posed earlier on, and just to highlight the fact that, you know, the impact of the pandemic, both in relation to loss of learning and in relation to mental health and wellbeing issues, has not been uniform across the country. And, you know, there is evidence, very firm evidence now, that those in most deprived communities have been hit hardest by this in a great many ways. And it's to make the point, you know, further to discussions that were going on earlier on within this week in relation to pupil equity funding and attainment funding, that it's very, very important within the Education Recovery Plan, which government has produced, that recognition of the kind of inequitable impact which COVID has had on young people across Scotland is dealt with in relation to the way in which funding actually gets targeted towards those who have been hit hardest. And the whole notion of a school empowerment and enabling schools to respond to specific circumstances within their local community through funding and through access to staffing and support is absolutely critical going forward to be able to target resources to most specific need in a way in which actually will get to young people quickly and in a way which is accessible to them and in a form which they can actually use to compensate for what has happened in relation to the disruption in their learning and the sort of health and wellbeing issues which they now live within on account of what's happened within COVID. So my cry is very much for let schools get access to the resources in a way which is getting to frontline problems as quickly as they possibly can. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can we move on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thanks very much to the panel for all coming along today. I'm going to go back to vaccinations just for a second, because ultimately we all know that that's the road out of the, or at least being able to manage our lives going forward. Gary, you said earlier on that you don't know how many members of staff aren't vaccinated. You don't know what the numbers are. Do you think that we should know how many staff have been vaccinated?
I certainly think there is dialogue regularly with all local authorities and their local public health departments, and that's one of the positives that's come out of this, the way there's a collective ambition to try to tackle these challenges head on. It certainly would be helpful to know the information. It may be that different local authorities get different information from public health. I'm just not party to that information in terms of the role that I do within IDS just now. But certainly that information would be helpful if local authorities could look at how individually their authority compares with others. Then again, it's a matter of trying to strengthen the communication and both at local authority level and at local school level to try to increase the number of staff that have been vaccinated. So certainly any information and statistics that help increase the mitigation would always be helpful in this instance, Jim.
Larry, can I ask you the same question?
I think we do have the figures in terms of teacher numbers, because the monitoring process with teachers is linked to GTCS registration, and from memory, it's in the mid 90%, so it's actually higher than the general population for teaching. The figure around support staff is less precise because they're not registered with the GTCS. So there's a kind of proxy taken in terms of the age profile, but that data is presented to CERG. So I can certainly reassure the committee that in terms of teacher vaccinations, it's a very high level of teacher vaccination, with most teachers who are not vaccinated having, you know, medical reasons why that would be the case. But the general point of vaccination, I think, is important. I do. If I can just make the point, Jim, I do think Scotland has been poorly served by the JCVI, which to me has dithered around the issue of vaccinations. We would have prioritised school staff right from the start, and we certainly would have moved much quicker on 16 and 17-year-olds. They didn't make a non-decision eventually until the UK government pressed them around the English schools reopening. If we'd had a decision around vaccinating 16 and 17-year-olds, which is running about 80% now, we would have had less disruption. And I hope they make a quicker decision around 5 to 11-year-olds, because I think vaccination should be offered there to the families of those young people.
Okay, you've actually just been, what a segue, Larry. You're good at this. You will all have received the email this morning from Laura, who is clearly very, very concerned about young people's health on the basis that 5-year-olds and upwards haven't been vaccinated. I'm going to go to all the panellists. Do you feel that 5-year-olds should be given the option of getting the vaccine? Larry, I'll start with you. You're on the screen.
Just to finish in, we are in favour of young people being offered that vaccine, and we've said so at CERG. Was surprised to discover at CERG that apparently there is no licensed vaccine for that age group in the UK at the moment, although clearly the USA have started vaccinating that particular group. So hopefully there is some work going on to make sure that if a decision is taken to allow that age group to be vaccinated, there will be a licensed product available to them. But ultimately, we think offering the vaccination is a quicker and safer route than just allowing for herd immunity to develop over a longer period of time, because that would be more disruptive to school education. But we absolutely accept it should be informed decisions. It will be for young people and their families to decide whether they want to access the vaccine if it's made available.
Margaret, can I ask you the same question? Margaret's on mute.
Oh.
Try again.
And for once, that wasn't my own fault. there's no clear consensus from parents about even the vaccination that's ongoing just now. There's actually quite huge concerns, I would say, that I get in. But again, luckily, we're working in partnership with Public Health Scotland to answer the parents' concerns. But again, that as Larry's just said, it'll be down to personal choice. Us as a forum will obviously just try and get clear communication for parents on their behalf, really. But I can't see that there's going to probably be any right answer to that.
Okay. What I can say is that Devi Sridhar has quite publicly stated that she feels it's absolutely essential that five-year-olds get given the option to do it, but I fully understand that, parents may have a different view. I'm going to very quickly move on just now to... Jim, you talked earlier on about the clear division between areas of deprivation, the levels of infection that are there. So there's a question here for, first of all, yourself, but I also want to go back to Gary. Is the compliance in schools of the rules, the baseline measures that we had, is it harder to maintain in the areas of deprivation? And will this ultimately, if we don't do something about it at the moment, make it even harder to close the attainment gap?
To answer your first question, Jim, there is no evidence that compliance is driven or influenced in any way by deprivation, if you want to look at it in that very, very crude way. Compliance varies across the country, but for different reasons in different parts of the country. It may well be, but there's no, certainly I'm not aware of any evidence which suggests that it's harder to impose within areas of deprivation. It is a challenge across the country. And sorry, what was the second thing you were looking for?
You made the point earlier on that the areas of deprivation have been hit harder. Is that going to make it harder for us to close the attainment gap?
It absolutely is, yes. And that, the challenges which young people in those areas were facing pre-COVID have only been amplified by what has happened within COVID. And that the OECD and the government's international advisors made it quite clear that learning at home was a significant challenge for young people in deprived areas. They did not have access either to the hardware, they did not have access to broadband, and they did not have access to a level of parental support and encouragement which less deprived children had. So it is very definitely going to increase the challenge presented in closing the attainment gap. There's no doubt in that.
Gary, can I get the same questions to yourself, please?
Can, and I would have to echo exactly the comments that Jim made there in terms of there's no link to baseline compliance or evidence to suggest that the areas of deprivation are suffering from that. But certainly, conversely, in terms of closing the attainment gap, absolutely there is a definite link to increased challenge associated with those areas of deprivation. And I think the point that Jim made earlier on around the Scottish Attainment Challenge Fund, looking at the new ways to distribute that, it certainly will give schools autonomy in terms of how they wanted to address that individually, and the autonomous devolution of that funds to schools is welcomed for that particular point that was raised.
Delary or Margaret, either of you want to add anything to that?
Just to say, I attended last night as an accreditor a presentation from four primary school leadership teams in Glasgow around their learning journey during the pandemic. And it was genuinely inspiring to hear how schools had coped from physically distributing food parcels to families in the early part of lockdown, to maintaining a high level of professional development and focus. But one of the things that they all highlighted in their presentations was the benefit of having some autonomy around how they addressed the issues, because they knew their school community better than anyone at a higher level. And that autonomy being matched, as we've just heard, to funding that allowed them to do things. I mean, one of the really big challenges we're facing, the crisis around additional support needs has been deepened by the pandemic. So pre-pandemic, one in four pupils were recorded as having additional support needs in Scotland, and I'm sure that figure has intensified across the pandemic. And that is a really challenging scenario if you're in a school community where the majority of your pupils from poorer backgrounds and have additional support needs, unless you have staffing resource, both in terms of teachers, support staff to address the needs of those children, then you're going to fail and the attainment gap is going to widen. That is, I think, we've talked about additional support needs and the challenge around it for some time. I think we need to recognise that the pandemic has actually deepened that challenge. And we need to focus on addressing that quite specifically, I think, if we're going to make progress on it, because generalities don't work. If you've got a class in front of you where 15 out of 30 kids need additional support and all you've got is one support assistant. So that's a really micro issue that we need to make sure we're addressing and supporting schools to tackle.
Okay, one very last quick point if I've got time, convener. going back to Murdo's point earlier on, the allowing parents to get into schools to see nativity plays and all the rest of it, or whatever else it is that they're doing. And I absolutely take on board that the purpose of this is to keep people safe. But would you have any confidence to allow parents into the school if they had a COVID passport or a negative lateral flow test? Larry, I'll start with you.
That's an interesting question.
Left the best to last.
Outside of schools, I'm in favour of COVID passports. You know, I understand, if I want to go to the pub or I want to go to the Celtic game, I have to show my vaccine passport. I understand that. What would a school do if some parents objected to not being allowed into the nativity play because they object to getting the vaccine? Would the school have to then become the gatekeeper to who was allowed in and who wasn't allowed in? So I think you'd be placing schools in quite an invidious situation there. They're not, it's not the Theatre Royal. They're not commercial enterprises that have to operate the rules in order to make their profit. So whilst I can see the validity in what you're suggesting, it may actually be quite divisive because only some parents could get in and some would have to be turned away. And I don't think school leadership teams at this time really need that additional headache at this time of year. So, the principle sounds inviting, but I think operationally it can be very difficult for schools to try and do that.
Okay, thanks very much. Anybody else want to add to that? Yeah, Jim. Yep, and Gary. Yep, okay.
Emphasise Larry's point. I was at Hampden last week, and you're supposed to have your passport checked before you get in there. It was just absolute nonsense. Now, admittedly, that's a larger number. But Larry's point is well made. Who actually, at the school door, if you're bringing in a secondary school, round about 200 parents into the school, some of whom have their passports, some of them don't. It's an unreasonable and unworkable way of trying to run any sort of event. And the second point is, school leadership teams are under the cosh, hugely under the cosh at the moment, just keeping the school working and keeping young people in there and being educated. To try and get them to do that and put them in a situation where it's going to be stressful for them, very stressful and very confrontational for them, I think is an impractical way of taking things forward. So exactly the same position as Larry, I think I'm saying. Thank you.
Thank you. Gary?
I couldn't have put it any better. School management teams are absolutely stretched just now to the limit, to the max. Bringing in something that would add angst to the system, it would add bureaucracy, it would add additional workload at a time when we're actually trying to minimise bureaucracy and workload. And I think the challenge around the parental angst here would just add a whole lot of confusion to the system. So certainly, as Larry and Jim both said, certainly we would be against that.
Thank you. Can we move on to Alex Rowley, please?
Thank you, and good morning. Could I maybe start by, I know that when we came out of the lockdown and schools started to open up again, there was anecdotal evidence of behaviour change given that pupils or youngsters had been basically locked down for a while. And as you made the point earlier, primary sevens coming into S1, I mean, they'd spent much of their primary seven at home. So could I ask, just to try and get on the record, what has been that impact in terms of staff, frontline staff in schools? What's the impact and what kind of pressures are they working under? Maybe start with yourself, Larry.
The impact is slightly different depending on which age group you're dealing with. But certainly in terms of, for example, the transition from P7 there into S1, the feedback we've had is that schools are having to work very hard to compensate for the lack of effective transition. And more time and energy is having to be spent around wellbeing, you know, so that a lot of children, particularly younger children, had to learn how to re-socialise and reintegrate. And that is a big challenge, because if you don't have those positive relationships working in your classroom, then you're up against it to start with, you know, before you get onto the content. I think older pupils are very strong focus on their next steps in terms of qualification pathways, and that in itself is a bit of a catalyst and motivation for them. But I think the anecdotal feedback I've had is that the emotional well-being of pupils has clearly been set back, and you know, children are behaving a little bit less mature than you might expect for the stage they're at, and it's just a kind of consequence of the fact that their forward pathway has been disrupted. So not all pupils, obviously, but a big enough cohort of pupils are needing a lot of intensive support, just in terms of socialisation, being part of the school community. So that is a big time stealer, in terms of the energy and commitment of staff. So that's that. I think it's hard to kind of quantify that, but it's, you speak to teachers, that's what you hear about, how hard it is just to make sure the children are on board and learning effectively.
Thank you. And moving on to Gary with I suppose the same question, but could I ask? I mean, Larry has mentioned today a few specifics where he said that where additional funding is needed in terms of ventilation, then it should be clear that's made available. And I think it was Larry that also talked about the need to increase the staffing levels. But for the Association of Directors of Education, given where we are, what is it? What more should government be doing to support local education authorities or schools directly?
Okay. This is probably a difficult question, because would ADS refuse any extra resources going to schools? No. I think there are a number of challenges that were raised earlier on in terms of the full impact of the resource implication, the financial implication of the energy consumption is still not known. It's too early to tell what that would be. But certainly we would hope there would be an expectation, if that was demonstrated, that additional funding we made available to it. Going back to the point that Larry made around there were probably two things that were important. I think it might have been Jim that raised it as well, the ASN challenge that schools are facing is a significant one. I think Larry referred to it as a micro issue. Is correct in terms of the local schools, but notwithstanding that, there has been a significant increase in ASN demand in school, and as yet the full impact of that hasn't been quantified, but certainly the rise in demand has been significant. Larry also mentioned there about the transitional impact, particularly mentioned the P7 to S1, and again it's probably too early to tell, but there is an early recognition that our young people's emotional well-being has been affected by that, and some steps will need to be taken to address that. We do welcome the additional money that was come in to support councillors in schools. That's to be welcomed. We do welcome the additional money that's been put in to provide 1,000 extra teachers and 500 extra school support staff. But certainly, the experience that the feedback we're getting just now is that whilst those numbers are slowly being delivered on the ground, given the significant challenges that we've got in there, as I mentioned, more resources certainly would be welcome to address that.
Continuing on that theme, Gary, can I ask you, at this time, councils will be putting together their budgets and bringing forward, no doubt, a programme of cuts. Do you know, is education directors being asked by finance directors to bring forward proposals for cuts within education budgets in the local authorities?
I certainly can't speak for every local authority, but most councils will operate with a programme of asking every individual service within the council area to put forward some options around where cuts could be likely. There's no surprise to say that in terms of the resources overall, local authority finances are certainly stretched just now. That's been widely reported. So it follows that it would be right that every authority would ask every single service director to put forward a range of options for their particular area. Education would be one of them. The local extent of that would be determined by every local authority in terms of how it would impact on their effectively their medium-term financial plans that they may have in place at this current moment in time. But every authority would be different.
Okay, thank you. Moving on, Jim, to the same sort of question, Jim, but picking up on that last point there. I mean, given the massive pressure on staff, in particular in schools, but given the massive pressure generally in education, I mean, is there a case to say that education budgets should be exempt from local authority cuts? Does it not seem contradictory that we're talking here this morning about everything that needs to happen, and yet education authorities will be carrying out an exercise right now to find out where they can cut even more from the budgets?
You're absolutely right within that, Alex. And you leave COVID to the side, perhaps, and I'll come back to that in a moment. But ever since pupil equity funding and attainment funding came into the system, there has been a kind of sleight of hand that exists within the system, and that the monies are taken away in the way in which Gary has described there, kind of upfront when budgets are top sliced when they come to schools. And schools are expected then to make good anything which is top sliced by using pupil equity fund money and attainment challenge money. So I think there's got to be a kind of an outing of this at the moment, and that if we are identifying that there are significant disadvantages which have been visited upon young people and visited upon them inequitably across Scotland, that we get away from this notion of top slicing the education budget to make savings and then compensating it through a fund which was designed for something else. And even more so now, and that something else is even more acute in relation to what's happened to young people on the back of COVID. If you're going to devolve power to schools in a way which actually enables schools to be responsive to local need, then devolve the financing of it and don't use a sleight of hand to, you know, cover up withdrawal of funding with one hand to the giving of funding with another hand, which leaves schools at very best in the same position and not in a position to proactively identify and target need as it arises within the local community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Margaret, can I ask, in terms of parents and parents' involvement, is there, in your view, enough transparency around the finance and budgets that the local education authority have and how that's distributed within schools? And is there enough parent engagement in those processes? And is there more importantly, is there more that needs to be done to engage parents within this whole process?
Yes, I would actually say that there does need to be more done. I live in Falkirk, and 6 years ago I set up the Falkirk Area Parent Forum for that very reason. so that we could engage with local authorities on educational issues for parents, and it wasn't just open to parent councils. So whilst obviously I'm chair of the National Parent Forum, I've obviously been involved at local level. And yes, we have been consulted where I am. I mean, I can only speak from where I am. And ideas have been asked and we've put some of these forward. But yes, I do think it would be very useful if parents could be more engaged on all issues really of education. We shouldn't just be a tick box, definitely. And I think it would, and empowering parents would be a really good, parents have many skills and attributes that they could obviously bring to a school community. So I would encourage definitely to have more parental engagement.
Okay, thank you. And can I pick up on a point, Larry, that you said earlier? You said there's not enough teachers available in Scotland. My understanding in Fife, for example, is there was far more probationary teachers available than there was jobs allocated. And the answer, I certainly heard one councillor when asked about this, the answer was, well, we didn't need as many as there was available. So I wonder if you could say a bit more around that in terms of the availability of probation teachers in order to be able to skill up, or do we need to do more around skilling up? And the example I gave you in Fife, for example, there's an absolutely, totally unacceptable level of class sizes over 25, but more importantly, over 30. And I was a bit flabbergasted to hear a councillor say that whilst at the same time, these class sizes. I mean, is class sizes an issue? And where you've got, like in Fife, where I've got the figures for them. And on the same subject, I've also seen a drop in Fife secondary schools in terms of pupils for accessing the science classes, a massive drop in S4, which will have a knock-on effect to S5, S6, and teachers tell me they will then get moved out of those schools because there'll not be enough kids taking the subjects.
Yep. Well, there's a lot in there, Alec. I don't know behind the convener will give me enough time to answer all of that. So just in terms of probationers, we have a system whereby each local authority takes a certain number of probationers, but then they can get additional ones which are fully funded. Some councils were quite good at taking additional probationers because it was a budget saving for them, because the Scottish Government were paying for them and they were filling a post. And those were the councils, and I think Fife was one of them, which then couldn't match the probationers, just in vacancies. And the Dumfries and Galloway was another area. So one of the things that we have pushed, because a year ago we were citing the figure that 10% of the teachers in Scotland were on temporary contracts. And we were pushing that with the Scottish Government to say this is scandalous in the middle of the pandemic when we need every teacher. So there has been some progress around that, and we're looking to create more permanent posts. But we have another challenge in that the school demographic is changing. So we've had quite high pupil numbers in primary, which is now tailing off, and that is going into secondary. So there'll be a demand for more secondary teachers, and there's a bit of leeway in primary. And what we are arguing for is that in primary, we should be looking to do something like cut the class sizes in primary one in order to, not primary one, sorry, primary two and three, because primary one was delivered by the SNP government, in order to focus on smaller class sizes in that early stage. And in secondary, we need a big recruitment drive for more postgraduate students to come in and do the one-year course so that we have the numbers to make sure we can offer the full timetables. So there is, and teacher numbers are the biggest expenditure in terms of education budgets. But even your question around budget cuts, we would be in favour of ring fencing, the money around teacher numbers, so that we get a more direct correlation between the ambition of increasing teacher numbers and delivering in the classroom. But it is quite a complex process, and IDS might be in favour of ring fencing education spending because they wouldn't be, because they're under pressure across a whole range of services. I do think we need to have some stability, and we need to have transparency around ensuring that we have the right number of teachers in place. And when I said I don't think there's enough teachers, you can barely get a supply teacher for love nor money at the moment, you know, because of the absence levels and because of the additional teacher posts. So we need to plan ahead, because it's at least a year's running before we have the right number of graduates coming out, to make sure that we have the right number of staff in place to allow for things like looking at cutting class sizes, which would be a huge step forward in terms of supporting young people.
Okay, thank you. Jim, did you want to come in on that?
Yes, thanks, Alex. And you, in relation to the exemplar that you used, you picked Fife as an example. Now, Fife is only one of 32 examples which you could have picked. And if you look across 32 local authorities, what you will find are 32 different staffing formulas. The way in which the staff schools in Fife is not the same as in Dundee, and it's not the same as in Edinburgh or anywhere else. And as well as that, there are also 32 different funding formulas within schools. Now, we talk about equity, and we've discussed equity and the issues around about equity this morning, and how equity has actually been, you know, further exacerbated through COVID. Is it not about time we started to look at delivering equity through the way in which you delivered funding to schools and organised staffing within schools? Allow or put a national basic minimum staffing formula and a national basic funding formula. Put that out into schools, and thereafter allow local authorities to fund schools on the basis of need and top up that funding on the basis of need. Because not until you get to that level will you get away from the issues which you are picking up in the first instance in relation to inequity of staffing and the way in which your teachers coming into the profession are employed. Can we look at something across the country which actually promotes and drives equity as opposed to gets in the way of equity, and look at a basic minimum staffing formula and a basic minimum national funding formula, and take top up through PEF and attainment challenge funding as it is just now to make sure that you're addressing need. Thank you.
Thank you. And I do think that as a committee looking at recovery, these are important issues that I think we will return to, and I'm sure the education committee will also want to look at these issues. But thank you very much.
Thank you. I know that we're conscious of time and we have run quite well over our time. I thank the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do that. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and this meeting to move into private for the next agenda item. I suspend the meeting. Thank you.